So as promised, today we will be starting paper three. As you all know, due to the new format of your exam for just this year, private candidates, which you guys will fall under, minus those who are enrolled in a secondary school, but private candidates, you all are now asked to write a multiple choice paper, so paper one, and that paper would be 1 hour and a half. And then you also have to complete a paper three, which is 2 hours long. So first we will start with what the ministry gave. We will start with the specimen paper today. And then next week and so on, we will start with the other past papers from like 2018, 2019, because this paper three was only introduced in 2018. So the students who wrote exams in May 2018, they were the first to write the paper three. So we will be completing the paper threes from May 2018, then the ones from 2019, and the one from January this year. So today we're starting with probably the easiest one. This one is the specimen paper three. And what you all have to remember for this paper is that, yes, it's 2 hours long, and your responses are short answer questions. So pay particular attention to everything that we'll be doing today, because how you structure your responses and so on is very crucial when it comes to allocated marks. So because you have to, you're required to give short answer responses, it means that when you all are responding to the questions, you must answer in complete sentences. So I don't want, it's like a comprehension, right? So I don't want anyone to give their responses using a phrase or just some words. If you do that for CXC, trust me, your marks are not going to be very high. So you must structure your responses well. You need to do so in complete sentences. And you also have to look at how many marks each question carries so that you would know how much you are required to write. So just like in a comprehension, if it's a one-mark question, you just write one line. If it's 2 marks, if it's 6 marks, then maybe you have to write a paragraph. So you have to look at how many marks each question carries, and then you would know how much is required of you to write. So this is exactly how the cover page would look. Well, as I said, this is the 2017 specimen paper. After today's class, we'll be looking at the 2018, 19, and 20 papers. So you have 2 hours long. And these are just the simple instructions. This paper consists of 3 questions. You have to answer all questions. So you only have 3 questions in this paper, but the questions are divided into part A, B, and C. So it's just, the paper is very short. It's just 3 questions, but the questions are divided into different parts. So it says write your answers in the spaces provided. So you will get space to write your responses. And it says you are advised to take some time to read through the paper and plan your answers, because this is a comprehension and they give you 3 questions and they give you 3 stimuli to read. So you should really take some time to understand what each one is talking about. Try to make connections before you diverge yourself and before you get into answering the responses. So let's see how the first page looks. So the instruction says, read the 3 texts carefully and then answer the questions that follow. So as I told you all before, how paper three is that you have 3 questions divided into different parts, and they give you 3 texts based on the same theme. So after we read the 1st text, I want you all to tell me if you all could figure out what is the theme, and then we would look at text 2 and text 3. So we have to read all 3 texts, try to understand what they're talking about in order for us to be able to answer the responses. So when you are reading the 3 texts, don't read them separately and not make any connections. You have to make connections between the 3 texts that they give you, because all 3 of them, they are just talking about 1 theme. So try to figure out what is the theme of the text and try to paint parallels between them, because for the questions, when they ask the questions, they require you to make reference to all 3 in your responses. Sometimes they specify to choose 1 text, or sometimes they ask you about all 3 texts. So in your response, you have to talk about all 3 texts. So text 1 says it's an editorial from a newspaper. So the first thing is that we have a newspaper article. It's an editorial article. And what do we remember about newspaper articles when they are in the editorial section? Do you all remember what this section is about in the newspaper? That would be very helpful in you understanding what the text is about. Anybody remembers what the, when you send letters to the editor, when the articles are in the editorial section, what sort of articles are they?
Complaints.
I'm sure you remember. Yes, what did you say?
Complaints.
Okay, so people are usually complaining. So when you read a letter to the editor section, persons, so citizens from that country or a particular area, they are usually sending complaints to the letter to the editor. So we know from just reading that text one is an editorial from a newspaper, we know that maybe this person is going to be complaining about something. So let's see what this text is about. So the title is Discipline is at the Crux of the Issue. So what do y'all gather from the title of the newspaper? Discipline is at the crux of the issue. And what does the word crux mean? Yes, Julian, you would have you were in my class last year, so you would have seen this before. Discipline is at the crux of the issue. Anyone knows what the word crux mean? So if we are saying that discipline is at the crux of the issue, if something is the crux of the issue, it means that, well, David is not like a cross, but if it's at the crux of the issue, it means like the heart or the essence or the center or the core of the issue. So we know right off the bat that there's an issue and discipline is at the center of it. So we know that this article is going to be something about discipline, because discipline is at the crux of the issue. So there's some issue that we're going to see the writer talking about here, and discipline is the main thing behind it. So the first paragraph begins, it was triggered weeks ago when two female students wearing natural hair posted their pictures on Facebook complaining that their principal expressed disapproval of their hairstyles. In an interview with this newspaper, the principal said her only edict, which she indicated clearly to students, was that they be neat and tidy in their school uniforms and that certain hairstyles were simply not appropriate for classes. So from reading this paragraph, what's happening here? What is this article about?
About hair.
So we know that they're talking about hair, but what kind of hair are they talking about?
Mm-hmm.
What kind of hair are they talking about here?
Hairstyle?
Natural hair.
Like... Right. Yes, Jordan. So they're not just talking about any kind of hair, they are talking about the wearing of natural hair. And what's happening in this first paragraph? We know that there are two female students and then there was a principal. And what happened between the female students and the principal? These two female students, they were wearing their hair naturally, so they had natural hair. And how did the principal respond to that? Did the principal approve of the children wearing their natural hair? Yes, David, they said in the second line that the principal expressed disapproval of their hairstyles. So they were wearing natural hair. The principal in the school did not approve of their hairstyles. So y'all know, I'm sure y'all probably saw this at some point in time in the secondary school. Maybe there were students who had natural hair, and because of a certain particular hairstyle and so on, the teachers would disapprove or the principal would disapprove of the hairstyles. So it says that the principal actually had an interview with this newspaper. And she said her only edict, and an edict means a command or order. She said her only command was that she indicated to the students that they had to be neat and tidy in their school uniforms, and certain hairstyles were simply not appropriate for classes. So what do you all think about this principal? if the children are wearing their natural hair and she's saying that, you know what, I want y'all to be neat and tidy in your school uniform, and certain hairstyles are not appropriate. So Joshua is saying that she's straight, yes, because a lot of schools who enforce the wearing of natural hairstyles and certain hairstyles and stuff, they are the administrations, they are usually very strict, right, where they don't allow particular hairstyles in your school. So we know right off the bat from the first paragraph that the issue that we are discussing is relating to the wearing of natural hair. So let's see what the second paragraph says. We endorse these comments by the principal, whose intention, it appears, is to set standards for the school she leads and the students in her charge. Students need to clearly understand there are rules that govern the regular operation of schools and those that speak to the deportment of those attending these institutions. And that deportment has to do with the way you carry about yourself, right? So what is this article saying? They're saying we endorse these comments by the principal. Doesn't it seem as though, you know, maybe they're trying to defend the principal and justify, you know, okay, well, we understand why she's doing this. And what is the reason behind it? What is the justification behind wearing the natural hair and what the principal feels about it? She's basically saying, and the article is saying that, you know what, there are rules that govern the operation of schools, and you know what, students need to follow the rules, right? So I'm sure that there are certain rules in schools that you don't really understand, and it may seem a bit biased, but overall, in this paragraph, they're trying to say that, you know what, we understand what the principal is trying to do, there are rules, and she's just trying to make sure that the students follow the rules. So the next paragraph says, President of the National Council of Parent Teacher Associations, so the PTA, put the issue into perspective when she said, this was not about hair, but discipline and respect for rules. So do you all agree? Because, you know, sometimes right off the bat, even in Trinidad and Tobago, if the principal says, you can't wear natural hair, what's the first thing that comes to your mind? What's the first thing that a regular Trinidadian would say? If you attend a school and the principal or the teacher says that, you know what, you can't wear your hair like that, your natural hair is not appropriate, what's the first thing you all think? Or how would your parents respond? The first thing they were trying to say
why?
Is, oh. Yeah, and they were trying to say that maybe the school racial, the principal racial, the teachers don't like people of a particular ethnic group, and you would think that they're biased as well. Good, so the president of the PTA of the school is saying that, you know what, it's not about hair, so we're not having an issue about hair, but the issue here is that students need to have discipline and respect for rules, right? So that's what they're saying. They're saying that, you know what, in the first few paragraphs, it appears as though the principal is a bit racist, or, you know, she's against wearing natural hair, but that's not the issue. The issue here is that, you know what, we are trying to get students to be disciplined and to show respect for rules, regardless of what the rules are. So let's see what the next paragraph says. It says, we also agree with her on the point that schools are not just about the teaching of mathematics and English. Schools help prepare students for life. From schools, students go on to the world of work. And if they find it difficult to follow school rules, how will they fare on the job when there are regulations in place that must be obeyed? So what is this paragraph trying to say? The word fare means like manage or cope, right? So how will they manage or cope on the job when there are regulations in place? What is this paragraph telling us? Well, I have to give you a hint. It has to do with this single line here that encapsulates what's taking place. They say that schools help prepare students for life, not so? So they're going to further elaborate that, you know what, it's not just about, you know, the wearing of the hair and the rules, but schools serve a purpose. They help prepare students for life. And the example they're given is that, you know what, from schools, students go to the world of work. And then, you know what, when you go to the world of work, and if you can't follow school rules, then how would you follow rules in the world of work? So David is saying that it tells us that students have to learn rules from now because they will have more rules to follow in the rest of life, which is true. That's basically what this paragraph is trying to say. They're saying that, you know what, the rules, yes, we started from the school level because that's where students go to initially. But when you all become adults, you all will go into the world of work, and the transition period shouldn't be so difficult because you are accustomed following rules. Good. The next paragraph says, while there are natural rights and freedoms which cannot be suppressed, children in school must conform to the standards set. So, you know, some people may say that, you know, we have rights and we have freedoms, we can wear our natural hair. What they're saying is that once children are enrolled in school, they should conform to the standards set. So regardless of if you think that the principal is being racist, it's not about that. We know that everyone has rights and freedoms. They could wear, they have the freedom of expression, they could wear their hair how they want to. But what they're saying is that, you know what, once you belong to an organization, to an institution, you must conform to the standards that are already set by the organization. So just as if you go into the world of work, you need to conform to their rules and the standards that they have already set. The next paragraph says, this issue came to the fore again just yesterday. So the same issue that we discussed here in the school, it says that, you know, it came to the fore again just yesterday when this newspaper revealed that a new dress code was implemented for police officers, banning them from wearing dreadlocks, makeup, extreme hair color, or having visible tattoos. Some police officers are reportedly upset by the new rules outlined in a section of the RBPF policy on general appearance of police officers dated January 15, 2015. So what are they saying in this paragraph? The first issue here was with regards to schools, but now they're saying that this same issue, we're even seeing it in the police service, where these rules are not just for school children, but even adults, even police officers, they have the same rules. And the rules entail no wearing of dreadlocks, no makeup, the extreme hair color, or having visible tattoos. So what is this paragraph trying to show us here? Don't you think that in the beginning of the article, they tried to talk about rules in the school, but here they tried to show us that, you know what, rules exist for every and anyone, and not just only school children, because even police officers who are adults, even they have to follow rules as well. And the last paragraph says, we do not believe the issue at hand is simply the wearing of natural hair. So how does this newspaper feel about it? So they conclude by saying, we do not believe the issue at hand is simply the wearing of natural hair. So what they're trying to say is that, you know what, the issue here is not about the wearing of natural hair. So it goes on to say, the larger point speaks to upholding discipline in society and the need for respect for rules and authority, whether it is in our schools or police force. Without these, we would be a lost society. And it says, adapted from, discipline is at the crux of the issue, an editorial from The Nation News on the 22nd of January, 2015. So this last paragraph really summarized what the article was about. And what was the article about? It says, you know what, we're not targeting people who wear natural hair. The larger point, the bigger picture is that we are trying to promote a society where persons are disciplined and where persons have respect for rules. So whether you are involved in schools, if you are part of the police force, you need to follow rules. You need to have respect for authority. Because if we don't have discipline, then we will be a lost society. So, any comments on this article? How do y'all feel about this article? Do y'all understand what the article was about? Anybody want to share their views on this? Maybe you encountered a situation like this. You feel strongly about this. Anybody agrees with the article? Anybody disagrees? Because it was a letter to the editor, so it could be something that is arguable. So David is saying he agrees with it. The rest of you all, how are you all feeling about this article? Do you all think the article made sense?
Yes, it makes a lot of sense. I agree with it. Because if you don't have discipline and respect, you will just go out there and do your own thing.
That's true. And that's what they're trying to say. They said, and the very last line says, without these, we would be a lost society. So right off the bat, people would think that, people don't wear natural hair. They're against natural hair. Maybe people are racist. But what the article is trying to clear up is that, you know what, we are not talking about that. Even when they mentioned the no makeup and the tattoos and stuff, they're trying to say that, you know, it's not only natural hair we're banning. There are other things that we're banning as well. You know, there are rules. And once there are rules, you will have to follow the rules because we are just trying to promote discipline. And that's why the heading of this article is discipline is at the crux of the issue. Because the issue here is the wearing of natural hair, but they're saying that the main reason why is because we are trying to promote discipline. It's not because we are against persons of a particular who wear a particular hairstyle. But the main issue here is that we are trying to promote a society where people are disciplined. Good. So are you all ready to see the second text? So we know the first one yes. was about the wearing of natural.
I feel all is about hair.
So we know that the first one is about the wearing of natural hair. And I did tell you all that once they for all three texts is about the same thing basically. So if we know that this one is about the wearing of natural hair, then we know that, you know, maybe there's something to do with hair in the second one. So the second text is a song. So text two is a song by India Ari. Anyone knows who's India Ari?
Yes, a singer.
She's a singer, yes. Because we have her song here. Okay, so David is saying no, he doesn't know who's India Ari. Anybody else knows who she is? She's a singer, yes, because we have the lyrics to one of her songs. And the name of her song is I Am Not My Hair. Anybody ever heard this song before? First time y'all hearing this song? No, y'all never heard this song before? So this song is available on YouTube. These are the lyrics to this song. So let me show you what she looks like. This is India Ari. She is an African-American singer. And this is basically how the song goes. I will just play the first verse and the chorus for you, all right? But this is where the lyric starts from that you all have. So if you all are interested, you could go and look up the song on YouTube. But we are going to be analyzing the lyrics to this song because we know that from the first text that the issue here is about the wearing of natural hair. So let's look at the lyrics as to what India Ari is saying. So the first stanza begins. So just remember, each text we have to analyze it because the questions will be on these, right? So the title of her song is I Am Not My Hair. And just from reading this title, what do you all think about it? What message is she trying to promote? Because, you know, sometimes we live in a society where sometimes we get judged based on like the color of our skin, our social status. We even get judged based on the hair that you all have. So people just, you know, make assumptions and so on about your hair. So what she's trying to promote is, in this song, is that, you know what, if you're judging me and stuff, don't judge me based on my hair because I am not my hair. So that exactly what David is saying.
Own image.
Right, so she has her own image, and David even said that, you know what, she's trying to say that she's not her hair and she is just human. So let's look at what she says. She says, little girl with a press and curl. So here she's talking about when she was small. So she had a press and she had a little curl. At age 8, she got a jerry curl. So first her hair was curly. Then at 13, she got a relaxer, so she straightened it out. I was a source of so much laughter. So how people responded to this? They were being a bit negative, right? And then she says at 15, so 2 years later, when it all broke off. So the relaxer maybe damaged her hair and then it all broke off. Then she says 18 and went all natural. So when she reached 18, she decided to go all natural on February 2002. She said, I went and did what I had to do because it was time to change my life. Because what was she doing in this first stanza? She was basically experimenting with her hair, right? First she had the curl, the jerry curl, the relaxer. Then it broke off. Then she went all natural. Then she said, you know what? It's time to change my life. So she said she wanted to become the woman that I am inside. 97 dreadlock all gone. So when she went all natural, what did she do? She had a dreadlock, and then she said 97 dreadlock all gone. So it means that she did what? She chopped it off, right? She cut it off. Good. Then she said, I looked in the mirror for the first time and said, hey. So remember, when she says, I looked in the mirror for the first time, how was she feeling before? Doesn't she seem a bit confused? She didn't know what she wanted to do. She didn't really have a sense of identity. She was just experimenting and trying to see, you know, what would work best for me. So she said, after all of that, when she went through all the transitioning with her hair, for the first time, she said to herself, I am not my hair. I am not this skin. I am not your expectations. No, no. And then she repeats, I am not my hair. I am not this skin. I am a soul that lives with it. Because how was persons responding to her experimenting with her hair? People were just laughing at her, right? And then she's just basically, now she's finding her voice. She has come to a realization where she's like, you know what? I'm not my hair. I'm not the color of my skin. Don't judge me. I am a soul that lives within. Then she goes on to say, what she do to her hair? So here she's basically commenting on what people are saying, right? So she said, what she do to her hair? I don't know. It looked crazy. And then someone says, I like it. I might do that. Or I wouldn't go that far. I know. Ha, ha, ha. So how are persons responding? People are still having mixed feelings towards her hair, right? And then she goes on to justify to us what society thinks about hair. So she said, good hair means curls and wave. So based on the society that she grew up in and what she hears people saying is that people say that if you have good hair, it means that you have curls and wave in your hair. And then they say that bad hair means you look like a slave. And we know that it's the slave hair she's referring to is the African slave, right? So she's commenting on what society deems as good hair and bad hair. So good hair means you have curls and wave. Bad hair means you look like a slave, an African slave. Then she says, at the turn of the century, it's time for us to redefine who we be. You can shave it off like a South African beauty cream, or get it in lock like Bob Marley. You can rock it straight like Oprah Winfrey. If it's not what's on your head, it's what's underneath. And they say, hey, and she's going back to say the chorus for us. So in the end here, she's given us examples of different of popular persons, right? She's saying that, you know, like a South African beauty, you could shave it off. Like Bob Marley, you could get it in a lock. Or like Oprah Winfrey, you could rock it straight. So what is she trying to say here? The main thing is that it's not about what's on your head, but it's what's underneath. So, whether y'all have to, any comments on this song? Do y'all understand the message that she's trying to promote in this song?
Yes, she's being judged by her hair.
Mm-hmm.
And you must not take what people say, but just follow your heart and go with what's inside.
Good. And it's because, and she realized that because in the beginning of the song, she was a bit confused. She was just experimenting with her hair. And people were laughing, people were saying this and that. And then she's saying that, you know what, she looked at herself in the mirror. She just told herself that, you know what, okay, I'm not my hair. And then she decided to be her own person because she knew that who she really was a soul within herself. So let's look at the third and the final text. So text three is a poem. So the first text was a newspaper article from the editor, from the editorial section. The second text was a song. And the third text is a poem by Sunkissed Gem. So the name of the poem is entitled Resilience. Have y'all ever heard this word before? What does resilience mean? Sometimes we hear persons saying that they are very resilient. So resilience basically mean, right, so David is saying it means that you're strong, yes, because resilience really means that you have the capacity to recover quickly from difficulties. So if someone who is very resilient means basically, you know what, you could bounce back from any difficult situation. That's what resilience means. So let's hear what this poem is about. So we know that resilience means that, you know, you could recover quickly from any difficulty or any toughness. So it says, perfectly patterned particles push perpetually. So perpetually means constantly, right? So perfectly patterned particles push perpetually. Emergent, emancipated, elated, enthusiastic. So where would you find particles? Where would you see the word particles being referenced a lot in science, right? So they're saying that, you know, they're perfectly patterned particles. They push perpetually, emerging. And how do they emerge? They emerge emancipated. So they're free, they're elated, they're happy, they're enthusiastic. Then it says pushing proudly. So it seems as though something is trying to fight through, right? Because they keep saying push, push, push. And when you push, you are emerging, you're emancipated, elated, right? So it says pushing proudly, up through layers upon layers of denial, past denaturing chemicals. So if chemicals are denaturing, denaturing means to take away the natural qualities, right? So past denaturing chemicals and excessive heat. So what are they talking about here? Where would you use a lot of chemicals and excessive heat?
Salons.
Yeah, and like salons, right? So they're talking about hair. Like, you know, sometimes we put chemicals in our hair, we put excessive heat in our hair. So it says past denaturing chemicals and excessive heat, curls emerge, triumphant. So what situation were they describing in this first few lines up to triumphant? For any of you who have curly hair, you ever try to straighten it out, use chemicals, you flat iron it? And yes, then pass all the chemicals and the excessive heat, the curls just keep coming back?
Yes.
That's exactly what they're trying to say here. That, you know what, no matter how much heat you put, how much chemicals you put, the curls, they always emerge, they're emancipated, and they win in the end, right? Because they are triumphant. So no matter how much you try to straighten it out, the curls just always keep coming back. So what do you think they're describing as resilience? The curly hair, right? Which should be like your natural hair, like if you have naturally curly hair.
So then, and when you straighten it.
Yeah, or even when you straighten it too. So it goes on to say blatant refusal to be ignored. So they're talking about the curls here, right? The curls don't want to be ignored. Blatant defiance of standards. Despite countless chemicals and incessant heat, curls return. So despite all those things you do to your hair, the curls will always return. A complexly simple statement and reminder of identity and culture. Because what does it sometimes you we use our hair to help with us showcasing our identity to people and even our culture. So where we came from, our beliefs, our heritage. So it says our hair is as our land is, as we are ever beautifully resilient. So what are they saying here? That our hair will always be beautifully resilient. So no matter what you do to your hair, when it grows out of your skull, how does it grow? Exactly the way it was before, not so? And no matter how many things things you do take here, it won't always permanently stay like that. Sometimes you have to keep applying the treatment over and over again, keep putting the chemicals, because once your hair keeps growing, how would it grow? It would always grow exactly the identity that you were born, the culture that you were born into, right? So what is this poem saying about our natural hair? We're trying to say that the hair is resilient, because no matter what, the hair will always bounce back to the way that it was before. Do you all agree? Anybody ever tried to do something to their hair and the hair always bounces back to the way it was before?
Yes, I try to straighten it out a few times and it come back, will always come back curly.
So. Good, and I'm sure even those of you who color your hair and stuff, all they color your hair when your hair begins to grow, how does it grow? It grows back in its original state, right? It always goes back to the original state, and then you have to apply more chemicals, more color, more heat to the hair, right? So based on these three texts, and what I want you all to know is that you see the rest of this, the entire poem, they're written in, like, you know, capital letters when necessary and the lowercase letters. And you see how the poem ends? Why do you all think Ever Beautifully Resilient is written in capital letters? Why did the poet change from writing, you know, normal to putting everything in all capital letters? Why do you all write things in all capital letters? So David is saying to preach, yes. You know, sometimes even when you're WhatsApping people or you post something, you put things in all capital letters because you want it to stand out and you want people to know that, okay, this is the main message. This is what I want to emphasize based on everything I said. This is what is important. And what is important here is that our hair is ever beautifully resilient. So you want to make it known. You want everybody to know that no matter what you do to your hair, it's always beautifully resilient. It always goes back to how it initially was. So let's pay in some similarities now between the three texts before we get into the questions. So I told you all that after we analyze the three texts, what we have to do is try to, you know, pay in comparisons between them. Okay, the newspaper article was about this, the song was about that, the poem was about that. So we know that the main issue here, what they're talking about in all three texts is what?
Hair.
They're talking about hair. But specifically, they're talking about your natural hair. So did y'all find any similarities between the three texts, any differences? Maybe one felt a certain way about it, the other felt the opposite. Anybody made any connections between the three texts besides the fact that it was about your natural hair? Because in the exam, after you read the three texts, you have to try to, you know, try to paint some comparison, some similarities. Either you compare it or you contrast it. So you look for similarities, you look for differences. So let's go back to the newspaper article, right? How did the writer feel about the newspaper article? Didn't they say that, you know what, we're not talking about here, we're just talking about discipline.
Discipline and respect.
Right. They're saying that, you know what, we're not targeting people with natural hair. We're just trying to say that we want to promote discipline and respect. And in the song, how did India Irie feel? She was just trying to do what? Just, you know, embrace her roots, embrace her real self, and not listen to what society thinks, no matter if people laughing and so on. She's trying to say that, you know what, we shouldn't judge people based by their hair, the color of their skin. They have a soul that live within, and that's what's important. And then in the poem, they're saying that no matter what you do to your hair, how many chemicals you put in your hair, heat, whatever you do to your hair always emerges as ever beautifully resilient. So it's strong, right? So let's get into the... Yes, Lena?
This one has an alliteration.
Yes, lots of alliteration. Don't worry, we'll get into that in the questions. So the first question, so we know that they said in the instructions on the cover page that you are getting three questions. So we know that we reached question one and we see it's already divided into different parts, right? The first one says outline the main issue addressed in each of the three texts. And you see how many marks this is with? This is 6 marks. So if you have to describe the main issue in each of the three texts, it means that you have to talk about the newspaper article, you have to talk about the song, and also the poem. And you have to say the main issue in each one. And it's worth 6 marks, which means that you're getting 2 marks for your explanation per text. So you get 2 marks for outlining the main issue in the newspaper article, 2 marks for the main issue in the song, and 2 marks for the main issue in the poem. And that will allocate to 6 marks. So don't pay attention to the spaces too much. Yes, yes, it gives you space in the back in the booklet to write your responses. So we have 3 texts. We have the newspaper article, we have the song, and the poem. So could you all think about the main issue in each of the 3 texts? In each one? So tell me about the article, tell me about the song, and the issue in the poem. When you all have your responses, let me know if anyone wants to answer one before I fall on you all. Just remember, you are talking about them individually. So you can say the newspaper article, the main issue in the newspaper article was about... So David has given a response. David said that in the article, the main issue was that wearing natural hair in school is not the best. Okay, so he's saying that, you know, they said that it's not neat and tidy. Anybody wants to add anything to David's answer? So you're halfway there, David. You're halfway there. Remember they were saying that, you know what, we're not targeting people who wear natural hair. What we're trying to do is just promote a school culture where persons are disciplined. So make sure you include the word discipline in your responses. Anybody want to tell me about what was the main issue in this song? Anybody knows what was the main issue in the song? What's the main issue in the song? What does she keep repeating? She said, I am not my hair, I am not the skin, I am not your expectations. And then she's saying that, you know what, she's the soul that lives within. So Rihanna, what do you think was the main issue in the song?
I think the main issue in the song was to like people not to be judgmental, don't judge by the way I look.
Good. Like so people shouldn't be judgmental. Good. Joshua is saying Anna is saying that, you know, not to judge someone by their hair. Good. Joshua is saying that she's tired of discrimination. True. Good. And what was the main issue in the poem? Anybody knows what's the main issue in the poem? Jola, let's hear what you think is the main issue in the poem.
No matter how hard you try to style the hair, using heat or dye or whatever, the hair will always be the same.
It always bounce back to its original state. Okay, good. So let me show you all how TXC wants you all to answer this question. Do you all have any more answers to give me before I show you all how the answer should look? So just remember the question, right? It says to outline the main issue addressed in each of the 3 texts. So I'll be showing you all the math scheme that CXE released for you all to see how your answer should be. And I'll be sending you all this document in the group as well afterwards so that you all can have access to the answers. So just remember the question is outlining an issue addressed in each of the 3 texts. So this is how your response should look. So if you want 6 marks, this is exactly how much you should write for 6 marks, right? So remember, they asked to outline the main issue in each of the 3 texts, right? So look at how the response starts. It starts with a general statement. It says, while the 3 stimulus pieces chosen deal with the topic of the wearing of natural hair, it is dealt with from varying perspectives. Do you all agree? So first, we begin with a general statement about the 3 texts. What they're saying is that each one deals with the topic of wearing natural hair, but they deal with it from varying perspectives. So it goes on to say, the editor who penned the newspaper editorial used the topic to address the issue of the need to conform to standards and show respect for rules and authority if we want to maintain discipline in our society. Wasn't that the reason why the editor wrote the article? Because in the very last paragraph, they did say that basically we're not talking about here, we are just talking about discipline and maintaining respect for rules and even the authority. So that was the newspaper. The second one says, the poet's main issue is that wearing natural hairstyles is an expression of the person you are and it cannot be denied. So isn't that what the poem was about? That the wearing of natural hair is exactly the person that you are and it cannot be denied because no matter what you do to your hair always returns to the state it was. Then it says, while in the lyrics to the song, the point is being made that who you are is much more important than how you choose to style your hair. So what do you all have to say about this response? This is the sample response that CTX sent because this is exactly how they want you all to answer. So first to begin, if they ask you to outline the issue in 3 texts, your very first line needs to be a general statement about the 3 texts, and then you get into each one individually. Talk about the newspaper article, the poet, and then you talk about the song. And you see how much you are required to write for 6 marks, right? Good, let's move on to the second question. The second question says, for any one of the texts given, assess the appropriateness of that medium for the purpose of communicating the specific issue. So let's read this question again. It's 3 marks. For any one of the texts given, assess the appropriateness of that medium for the purpose of communicating the specific issue. Keyword here is the appropriateness of that medium. What is medium? They want the appropriateness of that medium for the purpose of communicating the specific issue. Anybody knows what the word medium means? And just remember, I told you all that for all the paper threes, they bring the same questions, right? So when you all get your paper three this year, they're gonna bring the same question, The only thing that changes is that they just change the text. So understanding the question is extremely important because CSEC just brings the same question. They don't even have time to change the question. So David, this is your very technical answer about the medium. This is a more of a science answer. In English or communication, medium doesn't mean that. You all ever watch those shows and they have people who say that they are mediums? What do the people do who say that they are mediums? Y'all never saw those shows? On ETV, they used to have one named Hollywood Medium with Boy Tyler. What does a medium do? Do y'all know people who are mediums? Who call themselves mediums? So Joshua is saying a witch. It's not really a witch. But it's people who believe that they could communicate with what?
The psychic or something.
Yeah, usually, right. So mediums are usually persons who say that, you know, they are able to communicate with the dead and they can talk to this and that and so on, right? So they are just the vessel that was used to talk to something else, right? So in terms of medium, they mean like, the means of doing something or the form. So how was the message delivered? In what form? Medium has to do with form. So for example, let me give you an example, right, for the medium. For the song, how was the message delivered? They use what? Then they use music, they use a beat. Yeah? That was the medium that they used in the song. And for the newspaper article, what was the medium that they used in the newspaper article? Right, so they used the print media. So they use, so they were the same paper. So we would call that the print media. So they publish it on a newspaper. So do you think that was appropriate? And for the poem, what did they use? The poem, well, they were the same words. So yes, in the poem, they would use like all the different poetic elements, right? So like Lena said, the poem had alliteration. So maybe the medium would be that they use a lot of literary devices and literary techniques, right? So just remember, they said for any one of the texts given. So you just have to pick one of the texts, it's just 3 marks. You pick in one of the texts and you have to assess the appropriateness of that medium for the purpose of communicating the specific issue. So do you think that that's the way in which they deliver the message to the audience was appropriate in communicating or informing people of the issue? Let's look at the sample response. So for part B, for 3 marks, they chose the song to talk about because the song was the easiest one to talk about, right? So your sample answer would be, in the song, the issue is presented through the use of rhythm, repetition of the idea of you being more than your hair, as well as the references made to well-known personalities. Didn't they do that in the song? So part of delivering the message to the audience, they use rhythm, so they use a beat. They use repetition because they keep saying that, you know, you are not your hair. And they also made references to well-known personalities. So this is how the message was delivered in the song. And then it goes on to say, it is an entertaining way of dealing with a serious issue that would be appealing. So they're saying that, you know what, putting a serious issue in a song is very effective because it's a very entertaining way. You'll ever listen to songs and the songs are really about serious issues. And then maybe if someone had to deliver a long speech on the issue, you all probably wouldn't enjoy it because it's really boring. But then when you hear it in a song, it's very entertaining. So it keeps you all entertained and excited and intrigued. And you tend to understand the issue a lot better if you hear it in the form of lyrics with a beat, as opposed to someone standing and giving a half an hour long lecture on it. So what they're saying here is that, yes, it was appropriate because of the rhythm, the repetition and the references. And also it was very entertaining it was an entertaining way of dealing with a serious issue. So are you all following so far with the responses, how the responses should look? And let's look at part C. So part C is the last part for question one, and we see that with part A, B, and C is with a total of 15 marks, right? So part C now is worth 6 marks. So remember I told you of the 6 marks questions, you have to write a lot, right? As you also in the sample response, you have to write a lot for 6 marks. So part C says, for any two of the texts given, so you're picking two of the texts, either the newspaper article, the song, or the poem. For any two of the texts given, choose one language technique used in each. So you're picking one language technique used in each and explain its effectiveness. So what does that mean? What's the language technique? What's a language technique?
Like metaphor, personification, those devices.
Yeah, so literary devices are language techniques. Yes, very good, Lena. So it says, so a language technique is basically the techniques that the writers use in their text to help in conveying meaning or delivering a message. So like when we did literary devices, when on that handle for literary devices, you would have seen a definition saying that a literary device is a language technique. Because it is a technique, it is a method that writers use to help convey a message to the readers, right? So the main aim is that, you know, they don't want the text to be plain and boring, but they want it to be heightened and increased. They want it to be a bit more exciting so that readers can understand what is being said, right? So they basically use these techniques so that the language won't be plain, but they want the language to stand out. So you're picking two of the texts and they're choosing one language technique used in each, and then you have to explain its effectiveness. So you see how many things you have to do there? So anybody remembers any language techniques that was used in anyone?
Alliteration.
Yes, so I remember Lena did point out in the poem, you said that there were a lot of alliterations.
Because so, it Lena starts with a lot of P's.
Right. So in the very first two lines they had with the P, push perpetually and so on. So in your response, you will have to give the name of the language technique. You could even quote the example. You could quote the line. And then you have to say its effectiveness. So do you think an alliteration is effective? What does an alliteration do that really helps in conveying a message?
One, pizza, 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 pizza,
pizza. And what does that do? Doesn't it help to add sort of like a rhythm to the poem? Or like even when you were saying the like the rhymes and stuff you all learned when you all were smaller with the Sally Soul, seashells by the seashore. It helps to add rhythm, right? It helps to create a sort of beat to it. So that would be the effectiveness. Very good. Anybody could think of any other language techniques that you all saw? Everybody just remember the alliteration. Let's look at how a sample response for this question would be. So you see how many things there are here for 6 months, right? So it says, the writer in the article, so first we're going with the article. So remember, they did say that you have to pick two texts, right? So Lena did the one for the poem. And this first response is that they're talking about the article. So it says the writer in the article uses generalities. Anybody ever heard the word generalities before? So if the word generalities come from general, right? And if you give in general information, what does that mean?
Stating the main purpose of the article.
Very good. So if you are given generalities, it means that you know you are just basically presenting information based on what the majority of people would say. So generalities is basically like a statement or a principle having general rather than specific validity. So basically, if you are being general, you are just talking about what the majority of people is saying, right? So in the article, didn't they just give us the main purpose or the general reason about the wearing of natural hair? And they went on to say that it was about discipline and not really the issue of the hair. So this response says, the writer in the article uses generalities, mentioning that students need to understand that there are rules that govern the regular operation of schools, and officers are expected not to just uphold the law, but to also uphold discipline. So they're giving the general feedback from what people think about this, and the main thing is that we're trying to promote discipline. It goes on to say, since most people would tend to agree with these statements, they are effective in persuading people to accept the argument. So you see how they didn't leave out that part of the question? The last part of the question says to talk about the effectiveness. So in using generalities, why do you think it was effective? And this person is saying that it is effective because people tend to agree with general statements and it helps to persuade people to accept the argument. So they use it as a method of persuasion. When you give people general feedback, people tend to agree with what the majority would say as opposed to what the minority would say. Not so? So generalities has to do with what the majority would say. So generalities basically means the majority. And once you give people information about what the majority would say, it's very effective because people tend to follow what the majority would say as opposed to what the minority would say. So do you all understand that first part of the answer? And that would have given you 3 marks because this is 6 marks, which means that you get 3 marks for talking about one text and 3 marks for talking about the other text. So the second text says, in the poem, the first 4 lines make use of alliteration. So we're identifying which text we're talking about, and we are naming the language technique. So now we have to go on to talk about the effectiveness. This technique helps to add emphasis and causes the reader to pay attention to the message as it creates a pleasant rhythmic effect. So they're saying that when you use alliteration, it is effective because it helps to add emphasis. And it even causes you as a reader to pay attention to the message. And why? Because it helps to create that sort of rhythmic effect. So do you all understand how your responses should be for these for question one, the 3 parts? Anyone has any questions about these, about question one? Yes, David. Oh, I saw that you raised your hand. That's why I asked if you had a question. Everyone understands how you are to answer these responses? Anyone is confused? Have any questions? Or do you all understand how you have to answer the responses now? Rihanna, do you understand? Joel and Sushmita, I'm not hearing from you all.
Yes, miss.
Good. So this is exactly how you should have to answer your responses. Just remember, I told you all that CSEC brings the same questions every year. So as long as you understand the questions and you all remember
just look
answers,
at the answers.
It's very easy. Yes, actually, Alina would tell you. They bring the same question every year. All you have to do is understand the answers, and then every time when you see the same question, you would remember the answer, and then you would remember, okay, I could talk about this and that, because they bring the same questions for you again this year, right? So let's go on to, so that was question one, that was with 15 marks. So remember in the cover page, you said that there are 3 questions, right? So question two now, it says, state 3 features that distinguish an oral presentation from a written presentation. So anybody here had to do a presentation before, whether it is orally, or maybe you had to write it out. So they want to know 3 features that distinguish an oral presentation from a written presentation. So the key word here has to do with features. So what do you, so anybody here prefers to deliver a presentation orally, and why? So here's just, you know, they're trying to get into your thoughts. They're basically asking general information, right? So for those of us who prefer an oral presentation, why do you all prefer to deliver a presentation orally? Or maybe you all prefer someone to give a speech to you all as opposed to you all reading it. So David is saying that because the speaker could emphasize words and the speaker could also explain the topic, good. What again? So David has two points already. Why do you all prefer to listen to someone giving a speech as opposed, or you prefer to give a speech instead of reading it or writing it? So David says it could also make it interesting. And how could this speaker make it interesting? By doing what?
To get the audience attention.
Yes, you can get the audience attention even when you're giving a speech. So normally saying a tone of voice. Tone of voice is important because maybe the person would know when to raise their voice, when to lower it. Tone of voice is important. Good. And for those of you who prefer written, what about the written?
Outline and the main topic of it.
Mm-hmm. So in the written presentation, we tend to not like that because we think that is boring, right? But just remember, the main question is saying that you have to distinguish, you have to find three features that distinguish an oral from a written. So you basically have to say, you know what, why should you all do an oral presentation as opposed to a written presentation? So you all basically captured majority of the responses that that were required of you. So for example, let's look at the first response. So just remember, that more than 90% of human communication consists of body language. Do you all know that? More than 90% of human communication consists of body language. So you are better able to understand how persons are feeling and to understand what is being said if you look at someone's body language, not so?
Yeah, so like, when they speak orally, they tend to raise their hands a lot when they speak.
But, yeah, and you can look at someone's body language and you are able to understand so much more about them, and they can even convey messages to you based on their body language. So this response starts by saying three features that distinguish an oral presentation from a written presentation are, and the first one, the speaker can gauge audience reaction and adjust his message accordingly, which is true. Y'all ever had to do a presentation in front of a class and maybe you are able to look at the audience and then say, okay, they're looking a bit boring. Let me just adjust my message. Maybe I can add a little joke here to keep them interested. So the oral presentation is better because you could just look at your audience and see if they're responding well to what you're saying or if they're not really responding to what you're saying. And then you would be able to say, okay, well, let me just, you know, try another joke here because this person looking like they're falling asleep, right? So that's the first point. The speaker can gauge the audience reaction and adjust his message accordingly. The second one says, it allows for audience interaction and clarification of misunderstandings, which is true. You ever had to read something, so like from a written presentation, and you seem not to not understand what is being said there, but the writer of the book isn't there or the writer of the article isn't there to clarify anything for you? And that's why some of us, we don't like to read, right? Because sometimes we don't understand what the writer is saying and the writer is not there for you all to clarify any questions that you all have. But if you are given, if someone is given an oral presentation, it allows for audience interaction. So, you know, the speaker can interact with the audience and even the audience could clarify any misunderstandings. So usually when you're giving speeches, maybe there will be persons who would raise their hand, who would ask you to say it over, or they would ask you to clarify something that you said before, right? And the third one is the voice can be used to create a desired effect, and this can help to promote understanding of the message, which is true, because sometimes when we read, the way how we read is a bit boring. And maybe we don't do the intonation in our voices to make it exciting. We just read in a monotone, so it gets really boring. Or even if we listen to someone read, we think it's really boring. But if you are given a speech, you could use your voice to create a desired effect. So if you want to say something that's really serious, maybe you could sound very firm. If you are making a joke, you could laugh, you could raise your voice. So it says the voice can be used to create a desired effect, and this can help to promote understanding of the message. So by you raising your voice, lowering your voice, making your voice sound a bit serious, however you adjust your voice, it could really help in promoting the message that you are trying to convey to your audience. Do y'all know any other features that could distinguish an oral presentation from a written one? One other interesting thing is that when we mention these speakers, the speaker gauging the audience reaction, we could understand the audience reaction based on their facial expressions, right? So the speaker will be able to read the audience facial expressions. So it's like the speaker is getting live feedback, reading the audience facial expressions, and even body language. So you would see, okay, who is slouching, who looks as though they're falling asleep, who want to put their head down, but they have their hand holding up their head. So the face-to-face communication has a lot of advantages. Part B now. Part B says, you have been asked to make an oral presentation and one of the issues identified in 1A. So y'all remember 1A when they asked to outline the main issue in the three texts? So they're giving you a scenario now. You have been asked to make an oral presentation on one of the issues identified in 1A on page 5. List 3 points you would discuss in the oral presentation. So they're basically saying that if you have to talk about maybe the issue in the newspaper article, if you had to give a speech, what are 3 things you would talk about? Or if you had to give a presentation on the song, what are 3 issues you would talk about? Or if you had to give an oral presentation on the poem, what are 3 issues or 3 points that you would discuss in your presentation? So this response is a very imaginative one for you to just come up with what, you know, you would want to talk about. So anybody would want to talk about the newspaper article? No one would want to talk about the newspaper article? Anyone want to talk about the song? If someone asks you to give a speech and this, nobody will talk about the song? Anybody will talk about the poem? So remember, this question is more of you thinking outside the box. We get him here into the presentation. If you had to communicate a message to an audience, they want you to pick one of the issues, either in the newspaper article, the poem, or the song, and just list any 3 points that you would want to discuss. So part B says, so it says in a presentation, so you see how the whole responses begin, right? In a presentation on the issue of persons wearing natural hairstyles as an expression of who they are, I would make these 3 points. So which issue did the writer pick? They picked the persons wearing natural hairstyles as an expression of who they are, which has to do with the song, right? I would make 3 points. So the first one, they will say, this promotes an understanding of cultural diversity. So maybe if you're talking about wearing natural hairstyles, you could talk about cultural diversity, that we live in a society where there are persons of different cultures and maybe we should have respect for them. The next thing is that you could talk about the texture of the hair allows for creativity in developing these distinguished hairstyles. Because remember, the song she was talking about, you know, how many different things she did to her hair. So she says the texture of the hair allows for creativity in developing different hairstyles, distinguished hairstyles. And the last one says it is a choice which supports a healthy approach to the treatment of your hair. So remember she was saying that, you know, when she did this and that to her hair, how her hair broke off with the relaxer and stuff. So she was trying to say that, you know what, if you wear natural hairstyles, it helps her, is, you know, it's a more healthy approach to the treatment of her hair, as opposed to if you put chemicals in your hair, because sometimes your hair gets damaged, right? So you could have any 3 points for this. They're just looking to see what you would talk about if you afforded the opportunity to give a speech on any one of the issues. So this is basically a creative response, right? Part C says, it's another scenario question. So all the questions so far have 3 parts. Identify 3 features of the group to which the presentation would be made and 3 techniques that you would use to hold the attention of the group. So let's look at the first part. This is 6 marks, right? So they asked for 3 things here and 3 things here, which means 3 marks for this, 3 marks for this, right? So identify 3 features of the group to which the presentation would be made. So, yes, these answers are very long. You have to write a lot for your marks. So 3 features of the group. You all remember when you were going to school and when in social studies, you all did groups and you looked at features of a group. If you have a group of people, features of the group would have to be what? Like the gender, the age. What again?
Young, old.
Yeah, so you look at their age, you would look at their gender, you would look at, okay, maybe your group, persons who are going to a particular school, maybe your group, adults, your group has to do, so features of a group, right? So they just want you to list three features of the group of people if you had to deliver this message about here. And then they said three techniques you would use to hold the attention of the group. So if you had to keep the audience attention, what are three techniques you would use to keep your audience engaged? So when you're giving your oral presentations in class, what are some techniques that you all use to keep your attention, the group captivated? So David is saying he would use tone of voice. Mm-hmm. What other things you all use? What other techniques?
Body language.
The body language. Uh-huh. Maybe you make it interactive where you ask questions. What other techniques? Do y'all just go up and just talk? Don't y'all use any aids? David is saying he'll also make jokes. Good. Do y'all use any visual aids when you're giving presentations? Maybe use a PowerPoint, a chat. You're like when people just stand up there and talk and they don't have a picture for you to look at or something for you to look at on the board. So you can incorporate pictures or videos. Any other techniques you all would use to keep your group engaged in what you're saying? So Nirvana is saying that she draws, get a lot of people, they like to use the whiteboard and they would draw while they are talking. So like whatever they are elaborating, maybe they would draw the image or they would write on the board. So let's see what the response has here. So it's, remember the question had two different things, right? They asked for three features of the group. So the first part says the oral presentation is being made to a group of. So if this person had to give a presentation on the hair and stuff, they would pick females. So that's one feature. You would want a group where there are females you're talking to because guys won't really be interested in this, right? This is more of a female issue. So we have females. Then the person is saying that they're narrowing down the age group of the persons. So they would want persons who are between the ages of 14 to 16 years old. So we're looking for relatively young females, and then we would look for participants in a cosmetology course. So if we're talking about cosmetology, it has to do with like hair and makeup and stuff, right? So if you're talking about hair, a good thing to do is that maybe you could target people who are studying it. So people who are participating in a cosmetology course. So you could be creative here. Maybe you could have chosen like participants or students from an all-female secondary school or something. So you can narrow down your audience. So that's the first part. The second part has to do with how you're going to keep your audience, how you're going to hold the attention of your audience. So it says the following techniques will be used to hold the attention of the group. So the first thing, the first strategy is that you would integrate relevant, supportive, attractive visual aids. So like your pictures and stuff. So you would have props and samples to heighten the interest and stimulate the imagination of the audience to the possibilities for natural hairstyles. So if we're talking about natural hairstyles, it's good if you show your audience pictures of it, right? So you have your visual aids. Maybe you can have props. You could bring a mannequin. You know, like in the cosmetology course, they just have the mannequins with the head. And maybe you could have different mannequins wearing different hairstyles. Or even if you could, even have persons like volunteers who are there just to give an idea to persons how the natural hairstyles would look. So the second thing that you would do is that you would allow for audience participation through the use of hands up, feedback to questions, giving them an opportunity to feel connected to the issue. So you would allow the audience to ask questions basically. So through the hands up, feedback to questions. And the last thing is that you would make eye contact. So you ever listen to someone give a speech and up to now they don't even look at the audience? Do you all enjoy speeches like that? Where someone just goes on to talk and maybe their head is down and up to now they don't even look at the audience? So you would try to make eye contact, right? Because you would want the speaker to look at the audience. You would not want people, you know, to just, you wouldn't want the speaker to be there with their heads down reading all the time and not looking, right? So make eye contact and display enthusiasm. So you don't want the speaker to be boring, because if the speaker is boring, the message will be boring. If the speaker is very energetic and enthusiastic, it helps to make the delivery a lot better. and also to help to transfer some of my energy and interest to the audience. So, you know, sometimes if the speaker is boring, lacking energy, you all tend to feel bored. But if the speaker is energetic, maybe the audience begins to feel energetic. So that's what they're saying here. You could transfer some of your energy and interest to the audience.
So did you get an idea to how
you could create your response for this, for number two? The number two question is basically about, it's basically about the oral presentation. That's what this entire question is about. The oral from the written, then the features of, then the points you would use in the oral presentation, and then the features of the group that you would make and the techniques that you would do, that you would incorporate to hold the attention of the group. So do you all have any questions? What do you all think about the question so far? Number two was with 15 marks. So question one was with 15 marks and question two was also with 50 marks. So far we have a total of 30 marks. Do you all have any questions thus far?
Well, what I could say, this is a lot to take in, a lot of writing, well, typing, I should say, for the exams.
It will be a lot of typing for the exam because remember, you have to look at how many marks the questions are. And how many marks the question are would tell you all or steer you all in the direction as to how much you are required to write. So that's why, but the good thing is that you all already know the questions that are going to come. The only thing you all don't know would be the text. But as long as you understand, right now you might feel like, okay, I'm having brain overload.
Yeah, keep practicing with the answers and stuff. Mm-hmm. Yeah, keep practicing each day so you will know it.
Good, because I'm sure right now some of you all are having a brain overload where you know, you all may say, okay, this sounds like a lot. But as we keep doing the paper threes, this is just the specimen paper with the sample responses. But as Lena said, when you all keep doing the papers and you keep rewriting the answers over and over, then you will realize how easy paper three is.
I think instead of memorizing the answers, best you write it, because writing, you will understand it more than just have it in your brain.
Yeah, and even afterwards, when class is finished, maybe you all could try to do the answer the questions for yourself just to see what you all remember. And then afterwards, you could always look at the answers because I'm sure everybody's not going to say the exact thing that the answer had. We all have different ways of writing. So just try to understand what the responses are saying. And you all can even try to answer this paper on your own with all the answers. And then when you're finished, then you could reference the answers as well. To ensure if you were going along the right path, right? So just remember the questions are the same. As long as you understand what the questions are asking, it will be extremely simple for you to get your responses. The only thing that's changing would just be the text that they're providing you with. But just remember, for the text, there's always three texts and they're talking about the same thing, but they're just giving different viewpoints about the same issue or the same topic or theme. So this is just the first one that we're doing. When we keep doing the other paper threes and you all get accustomed to writing your answers over and over and you see the same questions and stuff, it will become very simple for you guys, okay? So let's look at remember they said that there are three questions, right? You all remember the cover page said that there are three questions? So this is the third question, which is with 15 marks. So the third question now says, create a response based on one of the points listed in 2B above. So do you all remember 2B? 2B says you have been asked to make an oral presentation on one of the issues identified on page 5. List three points you would discuss in the oral presentation. So they want you to use one of the points that you would discuss in the oral presentation. And now they want you to create a response based on one of the points. So whatever three points you have listed in 2B, they want you to just pick one of the points to create a response, right? So it says you can use drama, you could use poetry, lyrics to a song, or prose. So if you want, maybe in your response, You could write your response in the form of drama, so like how a play would be, where you would have characters' name and you would have the lines that they're saying. So if you want, you could write a drama piece. If you want, you could write it in the form of a poem. Or you could even compose it as a song in the exam. Or the simplest thing to do is write it as prose, which would be in paragraph form. So what I recommend is that because this is a timed exam, I don't know if y'all will have enough time to come up with a poem in the exam or a drama play or make up a song in the exam. But the easiest thing to do is write your response in form of prose, which would simply be you writing up paragraphs. So it's 50 marks, so 5 marks per paragraph. You could write your response in 3 paragraphs. So just remember, you are basically picking one of the points in 2B and you are just explaining what exactly, you are just elaborating on what exactly you will be discussing when it comes to it, right? So it says your response will be assessed for relevance of content. So these are the things that you're going to get marked on. The relevance of content, the organization of ideas, the effective use of language, vivid word choice, and unique voice and style. So let's explore these different things that you will be getting marked on, right? So I want you all to practice writing it. If you all are really creative and you could think of a drama piece, you could write a poem, a song in the exam, you could do so. But the easiest thing to do would just be to write it in the form of prose, which is like a short story, which is basically essay writing. So write it in paragraph form, right? So let's look at what they mean when they say the different components they say you're getting marked on. So for the personal response, the following criteria will be used to assess the composition. So remember they say the first thing was content and relevant of response. So the focus of the response must be clear and must be fully developed. The actions or the events must be clearly motivated. So for example, there must be some plausible reason for the things that happen. The next one is that there must be rich detail, must create a clear and authentic picture and hold readers' attention. So whatever the issue is, just make sure that it is something that people could relate to and it's clear, right? When they say authentic, they mean something that is real. They don't want you to make your response too far-fetched where the audience is not able to understand what you're saying. B says organization, so the details or the events must be logically and effectively sequenced. There must be a memorable introduction and conclusion. So you must have an introduction and conclusion, either explicit or implicit, meaning it's stated directly or it's not stated directly. And there must be transitions, must tie the ideas together. So remember your transitional words? You have to incorporate your transitional words to tie the ideas together. Then C says effective use of language. So your sentences must be clear. The sentences must be deliberately used to affect style. The sentence structure is varied and complex. So you want complex sentences and you also want simple sentences as well. For the voice and style, the writing must be a reflection. It must be unique. It must be a consistent personal voice. Connection to audience and purpose must be clear. And individual commitment to the topic must be obvious. And the last part is the word choice. So vivid natural language must create a clear picture of characters and atmosphere. You must have the strong verbs, precise nouns, and appropriate adjectives must be used to enhance meaning. And original phrases and words must allow for reflection and thoughtful insight. So what are we going to write about? Do you all remember the options that were listed in 2B? Remember the first one was that you could talk about cultural diversity. The next one is that you could talk about the texture of your hair allows for creativity in developing distinguished hairstyles. And then you could say that it is a choice that allows for a healthy approach to the treatment of your hair. So when you're writing this, you're basically writing your speech. If when you have to give your speech, what exactly are you going to tell the people? This is what this response is about. They want you to write basically a mini speech. So pretend as though your audience is there And yes, you said you would talk about cultural diversity as one of the points, but they want to know what exactly are you going to tell the audience. So this is the part of this of your exam paper where you actually have to write out your little speech that you will be saying to the audience. So if we're talking about cultural diversity, what's a good way? How would you all begin a speech on cultural diversity? So remember, I said that this is 15 marks. So you can write 3 paragraphs, 5 marks per paragraph, right? So you're writing a mini speech. You can make a speech 3 paragraphs. If you all want to go over 3 paragraphs, you can make it 4 paragraphs. But I want everyone's speech to be 3 paragraphs, nothing less. So 3 paragraphs, because they did say you must have an introduction and conclusion, and then you can have that body paragraph, right? So you could write 3 paragraphs. If you want, you can write 4, but 3 is a good amount. So this response is basically where you all have to think about what exactly you're going to write. So if you had to give a speech about cultural diversity, what would you tell this group of females that you would be addressing? Because remember, in the features of the group, we said they're talking to females 14 to 16 who are participants of a cosmetology course. So if you're trying to promote an understanding of cultural diversity, how would you all begin? Maybe you could begin just like how an argumentative essay is. You could try to find your hook, because remember, you are trying to sell your generalities to an audience of females. So you could begin with your hook. You could even give your audience an example as to what is cultural diversity. You could give them general information about it. And then what exactly are you going to tell these students about cultural diversity? Let me hear from you all. What exactly are you going to tell these students about cultural diversity? So paper 3 is just basically, it's a real thinking paper where you have to be creative, think outside the box. So if you're not creative, you need to start practicing to be creative, right? So what would you say, do y'all know what is cultural diversity? Anybody knows what is cultural diversity?
Dealing with your culture.
Okay, dealing with your culture. So if something is diverse, it means it's different, right? So cultural diversity basically means that, you know, that maybe their areas, their countries, regions, and so on, where different cultures exist.
Like different religions. Like,
yeah, because remember, culture has to do with your beliefs and your practices. So if you're making people aware of cultural diversity, then you are basically telling them that, you know what, we live in a society where there are different persons who belong to different ethnic groups, different races, different religions. So you're trying to make people aware of cultural diversity. And what is the message you are trying to promote? That there are different people in the world and they should do what? Remember, you're talking to a lot of young females, right? So what message do you want to convey to them? So you give them a definition as to what is cultural diversity. And what is the main message you want to give to this group of females? So David is saying you want to tell them, okay, don't be racial. You want them to have an open mind. You want them to embrace other people's culture, have respect for other people's culture.
Discipline.
Good. Discipline, good. What again? And then for each of the points that you are listing, you could provide your this group of females with examples. So for instance, if you're talking to females who are 14 to 16, what are some examples that you all could use so that, you know, this age group could understand what you're saying? Like if you tell them, okay, have respect for other people's culture, there are people who belong to different races and ethnic groups and religions in the world, what example you all could use trying to promote us living in harmony? Maybe you could give an example of right here in Trinidad and Tobago. You could say that Trinidad and Tobago is a multicultural society where there are persons of different religions, races, ethnic groups, all living together. And how do we live in Trinidad and Tobago? Do we live harmoniously together, or are we in war with each other? David, you think that we are in war with each other in Trinidad and Tobago? Only in Trinidad and Tobago, you could find a temple and a mosque and a church on the same street. In other countries, you can't find that, you know.
You live in harmony.
Yes. So like in Trinidad and Tobago, we could say that in the Caribbean, in Trinidad and Tobago, we promote cultural diversity. We embrace it because in Trinidad and Tobago, you could find persons of different religions living side by side. Don't you all have neighbors who belong to different ethnic groups, different religions, and don't you all get along well? Don't you all have friends and family and stuff who
religion
have different religions,
have to do
ethnic
with
groups, cultures? Mm-hmm.
Religion don't have to do with anything. You just get along good. And what you believe in, it doesn't matter to the person.
Right, so
your example could use
the example of Trinidad and Tobago, that you know that some of us in our families, we have persons from different ethnic groups in our family. We have persons of different religions in our family, but we still have respect for them. We still embrace everyone's culture. Even in Trinidad and Tobago, when it's Diwali, emancipation, you see everyone dressing up in each other's different traditional wears and so on. So you could show them, you could provide all these examples about, you know, promoting cultural diversity, how we are a society that actually promotes cultural diversity. In other countries where, you know, they are really at war with each other, you wouldn't find you know, different religious places of worship next to each other. You wouldn't find people talking to people of different religions and so on.
You could talk about the different cuisines over here.
Mm-hmm. Very good. That's a good one, Lena, because in Trinidad and Tobago, we have different cuisines, but there are different parts of the world where, you know, they just only promote their food alone and they don't embrace other cultures.
Over here is only the steel pan, the instrument, we promote. What mm-hmm. other places don't promote? Here's the only place we promote steel pan and panorama.
Yeah, and even in in some countries, they only are involved. So culture has to do with your beliefs, your practices, even music and stuff. Some countries, you only hear one type of music, people not singing all different types of music. In Trinidad, people singing everything in Trinidad.
Mm, over here, they love the soca music.
Mm-hmm. So if you're talking, so think about, it's just young people you're talking to. If you had to talk to them, what exactly would you want to talk about? Because this response is basically they are asking you to write your speech. If you had to write your speech, if you had to deliver this speech now to these young persons, what exactly, you're going to pick one of the points you listed and you're just going to elaborate on it and give an insight as to what you are talking about. So do you all understand what is required of you?
Yes, I believe so.
Okay, great. So, for this response, I did tell you all that it's with 15 marks. I prefer if you all write 3 paragraphs, 5 marks per paragraph. If you want, you can write 4 paragraphs, but it's just 15 marks, so your response shouldn't exceed 4 paragraphs. I want you all to practice writing this for homework, where I send the answers for you all in the WhatsApp group, the document that I was showing you all with the responses, I sent it. So choose one of the options from 2B, and I just want you all to elaborate, pretend as though you are delivering the speech to the audience and write out your actual speech, because that is what is required of you for question 3. Where you have to be creative on what do you want to tell the audience. Remember, for question 2, we did say that the audience is females, ages 14 to 16, and they are participating in a cosmetology course. So take all of that into consideration when you're making examples, if you're throwing in a joke or something, take all of that into consideration and refer to examples that, you know, these young females could understand to something that they could relate to. So I want you all to practice writing this response to me, 3 to 4 paragraphs. An easy way to do it is try to, if an easy structure to follow is that you could follow the structure for the argumentative essay, because it's basically you are saying your point on an issue, you're saying how you feel about an issue, and you're also giving, like, you know, examples and stuff to support what you're saying, with your introduction, your conclusion. You want to begin your speech with a hook, you want it to be creative and so on. So I want you all to write this for homework, and please email it to me on a Microsoft Word document so that I would be able to download it and edit it and give you feedback, right? And if you're getting difficulties with this, just send me a message on email and I will assist. So any questions you all have about this before we move on to correct the homework? Anyone has any questions about number 3? Okay, good. And just remember that this was a specimen 2017 paper 3. And next week we will also be doing another paper 3. Remember, I told you all that it only started in May 2018. So we will look at that paper first, then the 2019 paper, and this year's January paper. So we'll be looking at all the paper 3s. Remember that the questions are basically the same. They bring the same questions every year. The only thing that changes would be the text. So in your spare time during the week, look at the question paper and look at the answers. Try to understand what the question is asking. Try to understand what the answers, what is required of you. And the more practice we do with the paper 3, the simpler it will become, okay? So let's correct the homework. How many of you all timed yourselves when you all did your homework? I did tell you all to practice timing yourself. I know here they have an hour and a quarter, but for the exam, you all have an hour and 30 minutes, right? Okay, so Sushmita, so she timed herself. Sushmita, how long did you take? No one should take more than an hour and a half. Okay, Sushmita, you took an hour. Did you check over as part of that hour? Was the check over time included in the hour? Okay, good. Anybody else? How long did you all take to do this paper? Or did you all not time yourselves?
Oh, 10 minutes,
good. And how many of you all did not check over? Because checking over is very important. Huh? When you are doing your multiple choice papers, you must ensure that you leave at least 10 minutes to check over your work. 10 to 15 minutes. So for those of you who took the hour and stuff, the hour and 10 minutes, I hope that you use the remaining of the time, because it goes on to an hour and a half. I hope you all use the remainder of the time to actually check over, right? Checking over is extremely important sometimes because you're doing the exam, you're anxious, you know, you're not really settled as well. As yet, sometimes we tend to make mistakes, right? So checking over in your exam is extremely important. I want everyone to ensure that they check over their paper. Regardless of if you finish the exam in 1 hour, 1 hour, 10 minutes, 15 minutes, try to use the remainder of the time to check over your work. So this was the June 2003 paper, and it begins with antonyms. I know that there was something conflicting here in the instructions, right? Here it says antonyms, but the instructions say choose the word or phrase that is most nearly similar in meaning. They're supposed to put most similar to opposite in meaning, most nearly opposite in meaning to the underlying word. So I hope you all did antonyms and you all didn't really pay attention to this error that they had here. So this section is antonyms. You had to find the word that was opposite in meaning to the underlined word. So the antonym section, any volunteers to do the antonym section? 5 questions before I pick someone. Anyone want to volunteer themselves before I pick someone? Okay, great. So this person would read numbers 1 to 5. You would, no, Nirvana, it's the entire section you have to do. You have to do numbers 1, 2, 5. So I'll pick, let's say numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. You just have to read the sentence and tell me what's the answer. So Rihanna, you will start off with section. The first section, you're finding the antonyms of the underlying word.
Can I do section 2?
Oh, okay.
You can do section 2. Because I know I'm going to get all wrong on this one because I didn't I didn't watch the antonym part.
Oh, you didn't watch it? Okay.
Yeah, so I did the wrong thing.
Okay, Rihanna is doing section 2. Any volunteers for section 1? Lena, I think you could volunteer to do section 1.
The prize winning garden boasted a profusion of rare plants. D?
Not D.
A.
No, A is actually the meaning of it. Remember, we're looking for the answer.
B?
The answer is B, as in boy. B scarcity is the answer. Okay. Number 2.
The new employee seems to be a very zealous worker. D.
The answer is D, awkward, because zealous means enthusiastic.
I really did the wrong thing.
Yeah, the synonyms, Lena, is supposed to do the antonyms. So number 2 is actually D, awkward. Number 3. We found it very hard to put up with his belligerent attitude. What you have, Lena?
C. Oh,
it's not C. Oh, you really did the synonyms. Yeah. The answer is actually A, prying. And number 4, he did everything possible to thwart the efforts of the relatives to have the will probated.
D.
No, the answer is actually B, ridicule. Because if you're thwarting something, it means that you're weakening it, you're obstructing it, and you are defying it. But ridicule means to make fun of. So the answer is, so the completely opposite meaning was 4B, ridicule. And number 5, I can assure you the judge told the defendant that the law is not vindictive. So what did you have for number 5?
I put E.
That is the meaning of it. The answer was actually, for 5, it was actually B.
I did the opposite.
Okay, Miss, I get all wrong.
Because everybody thinking it's the opposite.
So, numbers 1 to 5. I'm not going to ask how many of you all got up. Number 5 was B, vehement. So section 2, Rihanna said she wanted to do section 2. Section 2 was the usage section where you have to read the sentences and figure out what is the error, if there are any grammatical errors in the sentence. So if not, you just put the no error. So Rihanna, you can start with number 6.
She was not feeling well at the beginning of the journey and sitting in front of the car made it feel worse. C?
For number 6?
Yeah.
Uh-uh.
Well, actually, I put D, you know.
So why not tell me my answer?
Well, I don't know. I say Z, D.
The answer is not D.
B?
The answer is actually A. It's not well, but it was supposed to be good. Good is used to this as an adjective. So if you are describing how you are feeling, you would say good, because in this case, the describing would be the adjective. So you use good as an adjective, and we use well to, as an adverb. So in this case, we needed an adjective, so the answer was supposed to be good. So for number six, the answer is A. Number seven.
Mary, will you please fill up the buckets before the water supply is cut off? I perceive.
No, it's not C.
B?
Yes, the answer is B, fill up. Could you fill something down? You can't fill something down, so the that is a redundant statement. So full up, the answer is B. It's just supposed to be full. Number eight.
Any disease of the bones and joints which are due to deficiencies in a single nutritional factor can be prevented. C.
Not C.
Oh, God.
Joanna is helping you. Joanna is right. The answer is A. Any disease is due to deficiencies, not A. Number eight is A. You know, when you see the word any, the verb has to be singular. Any disease of the bones and joints which is due. The subject is any disease is. So the answer for number eight is A. Number nine.
No one in the island seemed to know where the prime minister could be located at, even though there was a nationwide search for him. A?
Not A. It's not A and it's not D.
B.
Yes, the answer is B. That at isn't supposed to be there, it's just supposed to be the prime minister could be located. So the answer is B. Number 10.
No sooner had he entered Caitlin's living room and begun preparations for the feast when there was a sharp rap on the door, at the door. B?
Not B. What do you remember about no sooner had?
Is followed by Dan.
Yes, are you seeing Dan?
No.
So it means one of the options should be Dan.
So A.
No, not A.
C?
C. That when is supposed to be Dan. No sooner had he entered Kathleen's living room and begun preparations for the feast than there was a sharp rap at the door. So the answer is C. Thank you, Rihanna. The next section is equivalent sentences. So you have to read the sentences and think of the sentence that is equal in meaning to what the original sentence is saying. Any volunteers for this section before I nominate someone? So, since Nirvana can't unmute her mic, I would read the questions for you, Nirvana, and you will give me the answers, right? So, number 11. Since I went to the shop yesterday, I do not need to go there today. What do you have, Nirvana? Okay, you have C. The answer is not C. Oh, sorry, the answer is C for number 11. I was looking at the wrong thing. Yes, the answer is C. It says, having gone to the shop yesterday, I do not need to go there today. That's the answer. Good. Number 12, bad spelling may not matter to some, but it is the mark of the second-rate writer and creates an unfavorable impression of his work. So what do you have for number 12? Okay, so you have B for number 12. B is not the answer. There was a better response. Not D. Not A. Well, I think we figured out. The answer was actually C. So although it may be of little consequence, some bad spelling classifies a writer as second rate and gives a poor impression of his work. Number 13 says, according to the witness, he did not see the accused man near the scene of the crime. What do you have for number 13? So you have A is not the answer. And it's not D. The answer is actually B. Yes, the witness testified that the accused man was not the man seen near the scene of the crime. Number 14, it says the firemen rushed to the scene of the fire only to discover that they were unable to save the building. So what do you have for number 14? So you have C for number 14, that's not the answer. Yes, Jolan is right. The answer was actually D. Despite the speedy arrival at the scene of the firemen found out that the building could not be saved. And the last one for you, Nirvana, number 15. The accident was due to the wetness of the road and not necessarily to careless driving. So what did you have for number 15? You have A for number 15, that's not the answer. So Juliana's right, the answer is D. The driver was involved in the accident, not necessarily because he was careless, but because the road was wet. So the answer for 15 was D. How are you all doing so far? After we finish the first 20, I'll get an idea about how you all doing. Any volunteers for the spelling section?
Me?
Sure. Number 16.
I put B.
Good. Separate is spelled wrong. How do we spell separate?
S-E-P-A-R-A-T-E.
Good. So number 16 was B. Number 17, which word is spelled wrong?
C.
Good. C. Territorial. C. How do we spell territorial?
T-E-R-R-I-T-O-R-I-A-L.
Good. There's supposed to be two R's before the I. Number 18?
C.
Very good. How do you spell disciplinary?
D-I-S-P-L-I-N-A-R-Y.
Well, yeah. This E at the end here is supposed to be A-R-Y. And number 19?
No error. D.
Yes, number 19 is D. Nothing is spelled wrong. And number 20?
C.
C, mischievously spelled wrong. How do we spell mischievously?
M-I-S-C-H-I-E-C-O-U-S-L-Y.
Good. So the I is supposed to go before the E. So right now we finish up the numbers 1 to 20. This is 1/3 of the paper. So how much do you all have wrong so far?
I have 5 wrong.
Okay, 5 wrong. I ran us 2 wrong. This is just 1/3 of the paper, right? So we can't get too much wrong. David has not wrong. Very good, David. Kiana, I think you all got some of those wrong because of the first section. I messed you all up a little bit.
Yep.
Okay, so this is the first 20 is just 1/3 of the paper. So let's see how the second 1/3 of the paper looks from 20 to 40. So this is where we get into the reading comprehension. This was a really interesting passage. Do y'all remember this passage? Numbers 21 to 36. What was this comprehension passage about? Do you remember this passage? Nope. Y'all did the homework so far back that y'all don't remember. Jolan, what was this passage about? Jolan says she remembers. You forgot? Anybody? Anybody remembers what this passage was about? Do you all need it to be read again for you all to remember? So this passage is interesting. I want to read this passage for y'all quickly because this passage, it's been a while since it appeared in a CSEC paper, so maybe this year could be the year that it appears. It says, I jumped in my car and for almost an hour, I cruised down every major street and examined every passing bus. During this hour, the peak of the morning traffic, I saw no more than 8 Negro passengers riding the buses. By this time, I was jubilant. Instead of the 60% cooperation we had hoped for, it was becoming apparent that we had reached almost 100%. A miracle had taken place. The once dormant and quiescent Negro community was now fully awake. All day long, it continued. At the afternoon peak, the buses were still as empty of Negro passengers as they had been in the morning. Students who usually kept the South Jackson bus crowded were cheerfully walking or thumbing rides. Job holders had either found other means of transportation or made their way on foot. While some rode in cabs or private cars, others used less conventional means. Men were seen riding mules to work, and more than one horse-drawn buggy drove the streets that day. During the rush hours, the sidewalks were crowded with laborers and domestic workers, many of them well past middle age, trudging patiently to their jobs and home again, sometimes as much as 12 miles. They knew why they walked, and the knowledge was evident in the way they carried themselves. And as I watched them, I knew that there's nothing more majestic than the determined courage of individuals willing to suffer and sacrifice for their freedom and dignity. Many spectators had gathered at the bus stop to watch what was happening. At first, they stood quietly, but as the day progressed, they began to cheer the empty buses and laugh and make jokes. Noisy youngsters could be heard singing out, "No riders today." Trailing each bus through the Negro section were two policemen on motorcycles who claimed that Negro goon squads had been organized to keep other Negroes from riding the buses. In the course of the day, the police succeeded in making one arrest. A college student who was helping an elderly woman across the street was charged with assaulting passengers. But the goon squads existed only in the commissioner's imagination. No one was threatened or intimidated for riding buses. The only harassment anyone faced was that of his own conscience. So what was this passage about? So Julian is saying that they're having a strike. Yes, they're having a strike. They're basically boycotting using the bus service, right? And where is this comprehension set? Where is this taking place? In Trinidad and Tobago? Anybody has an idea as to where this passage is set? Where is it taking place? If you know where the passage is set, it really helps a lot in understanding what is taking place here. No? They said South Jackson. South Jackson meaning Jackson, Mississippi. Jackson, Mississippi is found in America. And if you all know any history about Jackson, Mississippi, it's a community where, you know, a lot of racial tensions exist. So right now we know that they're mentioning the Negroes in the society and the policemen. We get an idea that, you know, maybe they're of two different races, right? That the policemen are actually white. And well, the Negroes, they are boycotting using the bus and they decide to walk to their works and whatnot. So let's see if you all understood the comprehension. 21 says, the writer was examining every passing bus because he was what? So why was he examining every passing bus? So Joanne says A. Yes, the answer is A. He wanted to find out if the members of the Negro community were using the buses. Good. 22 says, which of the following statements is evidence that the boycott of the buses was successful? So which statements told us that the boycott of the buses was successful? It's not D. It's not C. Answer is A. I saw no more than 8 Negro passengers riding the bus because they were trying to say that, you know what, the bus was actually empty. 23, the phrase less conventional as used in line 23 of the extract suggests that the means of transportation used was what? Because less conventional. Is that A? If something is conventional, it means that is what everyone's doing, right? So J, that says is D. Yes, the answer is D, unlike that in everyday use. If something is less conventional, it means that it's not something that we're used to. 24, in line 34, the use of the phrase, the way they carry themselves, suggests that the demonstrators were what? Yes, the answer is C. They were proud to fight for what they believed in. 25, what is the reason for the change in behavior of the spectators at the bus stops as the day progressed? Yes, the answer is D. They felt happy when they see how successful the boycott was. Good. 26 says the real reason that the college student was charged was because, so remember, we don't want the literal reason. We know he got charged for walking the woman across the street, right? But what was the real reason? For 26, is yes, the answer is actually D. The police were anxious to have evidence that the passengers were being threatened. Nirvana, are you asking for the answer for number 24? The answer for number 24 is C. Do you have the answer for 25? Or you need the answer for 25? Okay. So we just finished 26. The real reason why was D. The police, the answer for 25 is D. And the answer for 26 as well is D. So 26 says the real reason why the police arrested the college student was because they were anxious to have evidence that passengers were being threatened. 27, the phrase assaulting passengers is put in quotation marks to do what? Jada, tell me what you have. Joanne beat you to it. Jada, yes, see? The answer was actually A. Because when you put things in double quotation marks, it shows that you're quoting what someone says. So the answer was actually A to show that they were the actual words spoken by the policeman. So that's a term that the policeman used to arrest the student, that they were assaulting the passengers. But we know that that wasn't true, right? So the answer for 27 is A. Jada, you'll do 28. In the last sentence of the extract, it is implied that what? So based on the last sentence, Jada, what do you think the last sentence implied? It's not B and it's not D. Sushmita, do you have your answer for 28? So the answer is not C. So the only one remaining is A. 28, the passengers were terrorized and made to feel afraid. 29, according to the extract, which of the following applies to the demonstrators? So were they anxious to shout and laugh at the passengers? They were fully aware of the purpose of their actions, immune to the threats of the police, or they prepared to suffer for their cause? Remember the demonstrators, they are the Negroes, right? The demonstrators are the ones who are demonstrating that, you know, they're not using the bus. So which one of these statements apply to them? 29. Sushmita, what you have for 29? So Julian is actually right, 29 was C. They were number 2 and number 4. They were fully aware of the purpose of their actions and they were prepared to suffer for the cause. Number 30 says, which of the following is not a fact expressed in the extract? So the opposite of a fact is an opinion, right? So which one is not a fact for number 30? The answer is B, passengers were persistently troubled by organized goon squads. Because remember, they said that these goon squads only existed in the minds of the commissioner. It wasn't actually something that was true, right? 31 says, which of the following phrases best describes the mood of the writer? So the person who's writing here, which one of the phrases describes the mood of the writer? For 31.
Miss
Saga. Anybody had anything else?
Excuse me, miss. I got cut off. What number are we on?
Oh, we are on number 31, Lena.
Okay, I need for 29 and 30 and 31, yeah.
So 29 was C. 30 was B. And we now on number 31.
Okay.
So what answer you had for 31?
Let's see.
Joanne is saying C, so I want to know if anybody else agrees with her or if anyone disagrees. Sushmita is saying E. What is he saying in the first sound, in the first paragraph? He did say that he was
D.
It's not D. He said that when he went and he looked and he saw the buses were empty and stuff, he said he was jubilant. And if you are feeling jubilant, it means that you're very overjoyed, that you're feeling happiness. So how is he feeling? The best answer was C, he was proud and he was satisfied. Because remember, he said we were hoping for 60%, but then we got the 100%. And he was jubilant. He was extremely happy with what he was seeing. So the answer for 31 was C, proud and satisfied. 32 says, which of the following types of writing does the writer employ in this extract? So the answer is A, explanatory, meaning that he took his time to explain in detail what happened from in the morning, so throughout the day, and then in the evening time. So number 32 is A, explanatory. Number 33 says, a possible title for the extract is. So if you had to create a title for this extract based on the information presented, what would you use? Julian is saying B. Anybody else agrees with that or disagrees?
Wait, Miss, what was 32 again?
32 was A, explanatory. So Sushmita says B as well for number 33. Yes, Jada says B. The answer for 33 is B, the no riders today, because they did make that comment in the passage. And no riders today meaning that no one was taking the bus. So for 33, the answer is B, no riders today. Number 34. The writer of the passage is most likely what? Who is the writer of the passage? He's a what? So Nirvana is saying B, Joanna is saying D. Jada, what you have to say for 34? Yes, the answer is A, Jada. The answer is A, a supporter of the boycott. He is supporting it because he, when he said he was jubilant, he was happy when he saw the 100% participation, he was supporting the actions of the Negro community. Number 35 says, according to the writer in paragraph 3, the courage of the protesters could be seen in what? Yes, C, their willingness to walk to and from work. And the last one for this comprehension is 36. The fact that the police succeeded in making only one arrest indicates that what? Not B. The answer is D, that there were few Negroes riding the buses because remember, they needed people to make the arrest. If there weren't people, then they wouldn't be able to make the arrest. So the answer for 36 was D. So we almost reached 2/3 of the paper. Do you all remember this comprehension? 37 to 46, where do you all remember this comprehension from? You all did this passage already? study. Let me see if you'll remember where this passage was from. Anybody remember when they were doing this, how we did this passage before?
Multiple choice book.
It wasn't any multiple choice book. Y'all have this passage already. Yes, David, you all got this question in exams. Yes, from which paper did it come from? I gave you all this paper as part of one of the exams already. Well, sorry, this comprehension passage was in one of the papers I gave you all for exams. Do you remember which paper? Well, it's a good thing y'all didn't remember, which means that y'all didn't go to the paper to get the answers. This was from the 2017 specimen paper, which was the paper I gave you for your first midterm exam. This was the exact comprehension from the 2017 specimen paper. So you see this paper is a June 2003 paper, right? You see how many years later they brought back the same passage? So you see the importance of doing all these old comprehensions because they keep resurfacing. So this passage was when they were talking about man, how man has evolved from using tools and stuff from the agrarian society where agriculture was practiced. 37 says, man has always been involved in agriculture in order to do what? Why has man been involved in agriculture? Let's see. The answer is A, to obtain food. I'm sure some of y'all even practicing agriculture at home. Why are y'all practicing agriculture? To obtain food. 38, according to the passage, which of the following has man used throughout his life to improve his agricultural protection?
See.
The answer is C, tools. You can't do agriculture if you don't really have the tools, right? We have to use the tools. 39, the word adorn, as used in line 13, is closest in meaning to what?
B.
What you said?
B.
Yes, the answer is B, it's improve. Very good. Number 40, according to the passage, tinkers, tailors, and candlestick makers and weavers were all important in the olden days because they what? So Jolan is saying D, do you all agree? David is saying C. Or D, David is unsure. The answer is D, they were considered the providers in society. 41, in medieval times, spinning and weaving were considered what? Yes, the answer is A, cottage industries. Good, 42, the writer makes it clear that many villagers were what? So 42, Jada. What's the answer for 42, Jada? Yes, D is the answer. Involved in both manufacturing and farming. Good. 43, the writer suggests that the overall result of manufacturing has been to do what? Yes, the answer is D, raise living standards. So that's why persons were involved in manufacturing so that they could raise the living standards. 44, from the passage, it is evident that, what did y'all gather from the passage for 44? So Julian had B, B is not the answer. Anybody have a different answer for 44?
I had A.
Yes, A is the answer. There was much industrial activity in medieval times. Good. 45 says, the writer refers to man and men throughout because what? The answer is C. This is a conventional way of including both sexes because sometimes we use man to refer to both male and female. 46, which of the following would be the most suitable title for the passage? So if you had to create a title for the passage, what would you put as a title? If Okay, so Joanne is unsure. Jada is saying A for 46. Not A. Nirvana was the answer for 42. 42 was D, Nirvana. What's the answer for 46? Everybody seems to be unsure.
I think it's D.
D, the progress of man.
C?
No. The best answer for 46 was B, the Industrial Revolution. Industrial Revolution meaning how we came about to be involved in the manufacturing. Showing how man moved from the agriculture, but the main thing is that, you know, they were showing life before in terms of agriculture, and then showing how we incorporated tools, how the machines were introduced, and what the manufacturers are producing now. So they were talking about how we moved to the Industrial Revolution, so how things have changed due to industrialization with the setting up of factories and manufacturing places. So the answer for 46 is B. So Nirvana was the answer for 43. 43 was D. 44 was A. 45 was C.
What was for 47?
Oh, we didn't reach 47 as yet, Amelina. We now finished 46. 46 was B. We're now going to 47. And this as well, this advertisement as well, hasn't appeared for a while in CXC, which means that, you know, we should pay attention to it because it's been a while since we saw this advertisement, right? So you never know if this year we can see it. It's a short, nice advertisement. It says newly renovated snack time restaurant, 46 Queen Street, Queenstown. Too late to reach home for lunch? Rush into snack time. Want a bite after the show? Drive into snack time. We serve juicy hamburgers, tasty hot dogs, refreshing milkshakes, delicious ice creams and sundaes in the twinkling of an eye at snack time. So do y'all want to visit snack time? Y'all want to visit snack time? Is that something appealing to you all? Well, minus the vegetarian people. For the 47 says, in the passage, the phrase newly renovated in line 1 suggests that the what? When someone says newly renovated, what does that mean? So, Julian has A. Yes, A is the answer. The surroundings look more attractive, right? Because it was, you know, it was modernized, it was fixed up. So, 47 is A. 48. In the passage, in the twinkling of an eye means the same as what? What does that cliche mean? The twinkling of an eye. Jada has C very quickly. Yes, that is the answer for 48. The answer is C very quickly. The next one is 49. According to the passage, which one of the following does snack time restaurant claim to offer? So 49, Jada, is not A. Nirvana has C. Yes, the answer is C. Prompt service and enjoyable snacks. Because it wouldn't be reasonable prices because they never told us the prices. They did say the service is prompt, is quick, and they did put the enjoyable snacks. So the answer for 49 is C. Number 50. This advertisement is designed to appeal to all of the following except the. So who would this advertisment not appeal to? So everyone has that answer. The answer is C. If you are a diet conscious eater, well, then the hamburgers and the sundaes and the ice cream wouldn't be appealing to you. 51 says, in the passage, the author uses all of the following devices except which one? So 51, yes, the answer is D. There was no personification. We have the metaphor twinkling of the eye. We have the exaggeration with it being quick. And, you know, everything seems a bit too good to be true. We have the repetition with snack time. But we didn't see any personification. We didn't see any non-living things being brought to life. So 51 was D. And this last comprehension, we didn't see this comprehension in a while also. What was this passage about? This passage is yet to reappear because we haven't seen it in a while as well. Do you remember this passage? So let me read this passage for y'all quickly, and then we'll do the questions, because this is the last section and we need to pay attention to this passage because it's been a while since CSEC brought this passage, right? So we need to pay attention to the things that aren't repeated recently. So it says, land and air and water are filled with many living things, but apart from mankind, they scarcely ever change. Or if they do, it is over vast periods of time. Ferns grow and fish swim just as they did long before man walked upon the earth. The industrious ants continue their routine of self-preservation and self-perpetuation as they did when the dinosaurs ruled. But man, in his comparatively brief history, has transformed both the world and himself. His specific quality is purposeful change through thought. He is man the thinker. The human brain works like the heart, ceaselessly pulsing day and night from childhood to old age. That man thinks all the time is a familiar notion, but it is a less familiar concept that all human history might be best understood as a process of learning. It was by learning that we ceased to be animals and made ourselves into men. Far back in the warm jungle, somehow, cell by cell and reflex by reflex, the wonderful human brain was formed, and with it, our two other miraculous human powers, our fantastically intricate speech and our ingenious adaptable hands. The earliest tools were scarcely more than lumps of stone with a few corners chipped off to fit the hands roughly. But gradually, century by century, better stones are selected and they are chipped and smoothed and rounded and sharpened until they are not only efficient, but almost handsome. It is impossible to look at those stone tools and to imagine their makers without feeling pity, admiration, and affection for our clever, industrious ancestors, and without renewing our reverence for the growth of the human mind. After the stone tools came the control of fire, the skillful, almost magical transformation of lumps of earth into hard pottery and durable metal, the creation of the wheel. Equally wonderful, perhaps more wonderful, was the invention or development of plants. Almost everything we consume, except animal food, is part of a plant, carefully bred from selected stock, wheat, sugar, fruits, tobacco, hemp, cotton. Some intelligent man or woman found each plant growing wild in the jungle, tasted or tested it, and by patient experiment discovered how to rear and improve it. This was one of the real beginnings of civilization. In that slow, patient process, men improved the plants and the plants improved men. Men ceased to live at random, they settled down and grew together. Cultivated fields made men invent rules and observe seasons. Therefore, laws were devised, the calendar was established, and astronomy became a science. By such and other growth, we moved from primitive animalism through primitive human savagery to civilization. So what was this comprehension about? Yes, they were talking about, the last line really encapsulated what it was about. We moved from primitive animalism, so man operating like an animal, then to primitive human savagery. So with the thinking process, man continued to develop himself and we started acting like humans. And now we are part of civilization, how we are civilized. So yes, David, it is about the development of mankind. How we went from being from operating like an animal to operating like humans and then into civilization. All because man continued to always think and evolve and come up with new ideas, right? Man didn't remain stagnant. Man was always growing. So 52, the purpose of paragraph one is to do what? So Jolan had A, the answer is not A.
C?
Yes, the answer is C. To show how man has transformed the world and himself. 53 says, the writer's use of the phrase as they did when the dinosaurs ruled is intended to do what? How long ago did the dinosaurs rule? That's a really long time ago, right? So the answer for 53 is D, to indicate the length of time which has passed. 54, in lines 14 to 15, the writer's comparison between the human brain and the heart was to do what? Why was that comparison made? What were they trying to say about the brain there? The answer is A, it draws attention to the fact that the brain never stops working. That was the comparison. They were trying to show how the brain never stops working. When they say ceaselessly, to cease means to stop. So ceaseless meaning it's not gonna stop. 55, which of the following is not mentioned by the writer as a source of man's remarkable powers? So Jolan has A, Vanarana has C. What again y'all have? Sushmita has A, Jolan has B now. Jolan, you're confused. So 55, we have varying answers. So 55, the answer was indeed A, man's reflexes. Because the rest were actually the remarkable powers. The man's reflexes part wasn't part of the answer. So 55 was A. 56 says, according to the writer in paragraph 3, one quality of our tool-making ancestors was that they were what? 56. They used an adjective to describe the ancestors. Did they say they were handsome, unimaginative, hardworking, or reflective? It's not D, they weren't reflective. They said that the ancestors were industrious. What does the word industrious mean? That was the adjective they used, industrious. If someone is industrious, it means that they're hardworking. So the answer is C, hardworking. Says the writer's intention in lines 28 to 40, the earliest tools were of the human mind is to do what? 57, I'm seeing different answers. 57, B, B is not the answer. It's not C. It's not D. So we are left with A, to trace the development of the tools. First they were saying that the tools were just round, then they started to chip the ends. So they were showing how the tools evolved over time. First they weren't creative, and then they became creative. So it was tracing the development of the tools. So 57 is A. 58, in paragraphs 4 and 5, the author links the actual beginnings of civilization with the what? So 58. It's not D. It's not A. And it's not C. So that means that the only one we're left with is B, the cultivation of plants. That's what they were saying. That, because remember in early civilization, we would have focused a lot with plants and agriculture. So the answer for 58 was B. 59 says, according to the passage, in what order did the following accomplishments take place? So you have the options, refining of stone tools, creation of the wheel, transformation of earth into pottery, command of the element of fire, and perfection of plant life. So in what order did these things appear? So Jolan, you have some options. Is B your final answer? Okay, so Jolan's final answer is B. Anybody else agrees? Narana is saying B as well. Anybody else disagrees or agrees with 59 as B?
A.
The answer is not A, it was actually B. So we had the refining of the stone tools first, then we had the command of the fire, the transformation of the earth into the pottery, then we had the command of the element of fire, then we had the creation of the wheel and the perfection of plant life. So the answer for 59 was actually B. At the last one, which of the following is not suggested by the writer as a feature of civilization? corporate living is part of it. It's not A. Which one did they not mention as a feature of civilization? The answer was D, the domestication of animals. Very good. They didn't mention anything about that. So put your total out of 60 and send me your total. Just remember that your mark was supposed to increase from last week's mark, right? So put your total and send your total out of 60 for me. Remember, our aim right now is that no one should be getting below 40. Everyone should be getting above 40. If you're making above 50, that is excellent. Once you're making above 50 out of 60 multiple choice, you know you're going to get a one-over distinction for sure. So Nirvana, that's 55. Very good. Excellent work. Once you know you're making in the 50s, you're going to get a one-over distinction for sure. Okay, Rihanna, we have to go up a little bit again. Good, Julian. Very good, Lena. Very good, Jada. So just remember, our aim is that we want to make above 40. Okay, so Shmuta, we have to go up a little bit again. I think the first section, you all misinterpreted that one. That's why. Very good, Anna. Joshua, why your mark is like that? Joshua, did you not do my homework? So for those of you who didn't do my homework this week, I already sent you homework for next week, right? So you have from this Saturday, you have until next week Saturday to send the homework, right? And to complete the homework. I already sent the homework for today's class, which will be corrected next week. So you all have an entire week to start to complete the homework. So I sent in the WhatsApp group for you all. I sent the homework that is due next week. You have a multiple choice paper, the May 2016 paper. I sent the specimen paper 3 for you all, the 2017 one. And the other document I sent was the answer sheet to accompany the specimen paper. So remember, your homework is to complete question 3 in the specimen paper, where you have to write your creative response in 3 to 4 paragraphs, and along with completing your multiple choice paper that I give you all for homework. In next week's class, we'll be looking at another paper 3, the 2018 paper 3. So be sure to review the paper 3, the answers, the questions, because as I said, the questions are the same. So try to understand the questions and what is required of you when you are responding, so that next week's class, we could do that paper together as well. Do you all have any questions?
Next week's class is the last class.
No, next week's class is not the last class, Lena.
Because maths, right, beginning on the 25th study session, I think.
Really? A math study session?
Yeah, so it's crashing with yours.
Okay, I'll clarify that with Lyndon, but we have 2 more weeks again of classes, so we have 2 more classes. I don't think you'll have any study sessions for maths next week, Saturday. I don't think so. I'll have to clarify that, but I didn't hear that. I know that we have 2 more weeks of classes, so we have class next week, Saturday, and we also have class. Our last class will be on the Saturday, the 2nd of May. So we have class next week, Saturday, 25th, and we have class on the 2nd of May. So we have 2 more weeks of classes. So do y'all have any other questions? Do y'all feel comfortable about the paper 3? I think that y'all just have to go home and, well, you're already home, but y'all just have to revise the answers and the questions. And just remember that Lyndon was also advertising to you all the additional 5 classes that we're having in May, the revision sessions. So if you all are interested, you can attend the one for English. I'll be doing the sessions with you guys. So do y'all have any other questions? How do y'all feel about the paper three? Do y'all like it? Do y'all don't like it? Do you think it's difficult?
Just it's a lot of writing.
Yes, a lot of writing. Well, fortunate, you all have to type. Just for this year, you'll have to type your answers.
Miss, the paper three is the people who not doing SBA.
Yeah, the paper three is for private candidates. So if you all did an SBA, then you don't have to do the paper three. So like Sushmita, because I know you're enrolled in school, if you want to write exams in January, you would have to do a paper three. Like, you know, sometimes students write exams before in January, and then they would write it in May in their schools. So because you're writing as a private candidate in January, you would have to write a paper three. Because your SBA mark wouldn't be ready as yet to give to CXC.
Wait, excuse me, so much papers are you really doing?
You're just doing two papers. All those who are private candidates, you are just doing two papers. You're doing the paper one, which is the multiple choice paper, and you're doing paper two, which is this paper that paper three, which is the short answer responses that we did today. So you'll have two papers to do for CXC. And that will be the same thing for maths as well. Because the paper three takes the place of the SBA. So if you didn't do an SBA, then you have to do the paper three. So for all the subjects, if you didn't do an SBFA because you're a private candidate, then you will have to write a paper one, which is the multiple choice, and the paper three, which is the short answer responses. So you all just have two papers to write.
Miss, I don't have to do no paper three.
Well, if you write an exam, which is school in May, and you have completed the SBA, you will have to do a paper three. But only if you are writing exams privately in January before, then you will have to do the paper three. Do you plan on writing exams privately in January?
Not sure yet.
Because if you're doing exams in January, and then, because I know you're writing exams next year, May, right? So if you're doing exams in January before, which should be 2021, you would have to do the paper three. As long as you're writing privately and not with your secondary school, you have to do a paper three.
Okay, thanks.
You're welcome. Anyone else has questions? The paper three might seem a bit difficult because it was just the first class. You all have a brain overload with the responses. But as we keep practicing it next week, we'll continue practicing it. As we keep practicing it, you will see that it's basically the same thing you're going to keep writing. The responses are the same. The questions come the same every year. It's just the text changes. So you all will get the gist of it. It's a very simple paper. The more practice you guys do, the better the paper will be. So if you all don't have any questions, we would end class now. If you all do have questions, any questions arise between now and next week, feel free to send a message or email, okay? So you all stay safe, stay indoors, maintain your social distancing. And we will resume next week, Saturday for class. Please be on time for class. Please try and sign in just a few minutes before 9, okay? So please be on time for class next week so we can do as much work as possible. So y'all enjoy your week, be productive, and use this time to revise your work. And we will resume next week, Saturday, for class.